So my name is Ursula Matalonis. I know so many of you. I am a medical oncologist, and I direct the Division of GY Oncology here at Dana-Farber. It's a pleasure to see the packed room that there is today, and really appreciate everyone for coming out so early in the morning and being part of this, I think, great event. So I have the pleasure of introducing a quite esteemed panel of my colleagues who are really going to focus on early detection and prevention of GYN cancers. It's a topic that we get many, many requests for to do. And this year, we decided to have a panel focused on this topic. So the other thing I want to mention is that you have these cards on your table. They're not only cards, but they're actually pads of paper. So as questions come up, and you have a question, so we really want this to be interactive. These guys are going to talk to you about what they're doing from a research perspective and answer some questions from me, but we want to hear from you. So write your questions on the card, on the pad, there's pens on the table, and hand them to our development and planning event guys who are wandering around. So okay, here we go. Hands are in the back, they're going to roam around, and then hand them the cards. Okay, so I would like to introduce my colleagues on the panel today who will be speaking again about prevention and early detection. So Dr. Dipanjan Chowdhury, who's right on my left, he is the chief of the Division of Radiation and Genome Stability in the Department of Radiation Oncology at Dana-Farber. He has developed a sensitive screening tool for ovarian cancer early detection, which is undergoing rigorous validation currently, and it does hold promise to detect ovarian cancer at its earliest stages. And he's going to talk about where he is with this and kind of next steps. Dr. Eric Weiner, who's in the middle, my esteemed colleague and good friend, is the chief and director of the Division of Breast Oncology. He's going to talk about the current challenges in early detection and prevention of breast cancer, and the need to develop screening tools to test for additional molecular targets, and there are many of them, and these are beyond BRCA mutations, for earlier treatment and prevention. And then on my far left is Dr. Jen Ligabel, who is a medical oncologist in the Breast Oncology Division and is the director of the ZACEM Center for Integrative Therapies and Healthy Living at Dana-Farber. Her research is focused on the role of diet and exercise, as well as weight management, in cancer prevention and control, and she's going to talk about the contribution of diet, exercise, body weight to breast and GYN cancer risk. We expect a lot of questions for Jen Ligabel. So I'm going to turn it over to Dipanjan just to kind of give the audience a few minutes about what you do and your early detection test for ovarian cancer.
Thank you, Ursula. Well, first I want to take the opportunity to thank the Susan Smith Center and all of you for being here and organizing this. And a lot of people in the room, who they know who they are, have been supporting our research for years, and I'm deeply grateful and cannot thank the organizer of this party, Debbie and Bob, for supporting our project for many years. So the idea is to detect ovarian cancer early, but let me even backtrack. Even detecting ovarian cancer with a non-invasive test doesn't exist right now. So we started with this from the concept of new class of molecules. And when I say new, it means about 60 years of molecular biology, we have focused on DNA and mutations, the BRCA genes, all of you are familiar with drug targets. But then there are these other class, which are non-coding RNA, small RNA, which are in the tumors, which have been shown to affect cancer, every step of a cancer.
So, and the great thing about being the moderator is I can interrupt people.
Yeah.
So I want you to talk about and tell us folks what do you mean by microRNA? What do you mean by that exactly?
I will get there.
All right.
Sorry about that.
Touché.
Sorry, I went too fast. But
it's good. It's good. It's good.
So microRNA, as it sounds, it's small RNA, literally.
Good. So what does RNA do?
So these small RNAs are affecting the function of cells in many different ways. But just to be clear to this point, Right now, we are studying them as biomarkers. We just want to know whether the presence of specific small RNAs in blood can allow us to detect cancer or not. That's really what the project is. And the good news is that we can. So we can right now, and we have done over 1,000 samples of various different types of ovarian cancer, but we can with 93% accuracy today with a blood test tell you whether you have a malignant tumor versus nothing or a benign tumor. And the work that we want to do next is to go backwards, really see how early does this test work. That's where we are.
Yeah. I have one question for you, Dipanjan, before we move on to Eric. Is we know that ovarian cancer is not just one cancer. I mean, most of the cancers are high-grade serous, but there's also low-grade tumors, clear cell. Have you been able to differentiate the test results that you're getting with these different types of ovarian cancer histologies?
We are trying to do that. As you said, the focus has been on the high-grade serous right now. Mm-hmm. We had smaller numbers of samples from the other clear cell carcinomas. We are trying. That's something that's happening on the side. But the focus really has been the high-grade serous ovarian carcinomas and trying to say, you know, can we detect them at an early stage?
Great, okay. All right, Eric. So tell us about, there's a lot going on in early detection with breast cancer, both from obviously a mammography. There's a lot going on even in mammography. There just recent FDA call to place into mammography results the presence or absence of dense breasts, talk about genetic testing. Start. I mean, there's a lot to talk about.
So one could talk about this for about an hour, I'll try not to. And let me just acknowledge that they didn't really want me here. They wanted Judy Garber, who really knows about this. But they know they can sort of wind me up and I can talk about a lot of things. So I'll do my best to be Judy, but I won't be as knowledgeable or eloquent. So let's just start with the headline. The headline is that women who are between the ages of approximately 40 to 45 and 70 to 75 should have screening at this point in time using one of the published guidelines. The ACS recommends starting at 45 and screening yearly for 10 years, and then every other year from 55 and beyond. The NCI has different guidelines, and using one or another of these guidelines, you should be screened. But here's the fact. Screening isn't really nearly as good as we would like it to be. And with screening, and this is part of the reason there have been such debates about screening, with screening, we do save a few lives, but we don't save nearly as many lives as we would like to. And the real problem here, in my mind, is twofold. One is that sometimes screening picks up things that we don't even need to know about. And so that's a problem for patients. Number one, there are false positives. And number two, there are occasionally some cancers that just would never do anything in much the same way that exists for men with prostate cancer. But the second problem is why. To quote my colleague Hal Burstein, who uses this this comment in a different setting, why would you think that the amount of time it takes the Earth to go around the sun would be the right amount of time to do mammograms? That is, yearly, you know, and it would be the right interval. And so it really doesn't make sense that we've just applied uniformly one set of recommendations. And what we desperately need are individualized approaches to screening. And by individualized, I mean approaches that take into account a woman's risk factors, the density of her breasts, her preferences, her age, all of these various factors, her genetic makeup. And so there may be some women who really don't need screening. There may be other women who need to be screened with very thorough, very comprehensive tests every 6 months, every 3 months, any amount of time. And there may be others, probably a small number, who could just be screened as we screen at the moment once a year. And this is where we have to focus our research. And this is an ideal place to apply artificial intelligence, machine learning, all of this, you know, fancy new technology that can really help us sort this out. Now, I could go on and on about prevention, but I won't. I'm going to stop, and we're just going to answer questions as they come.
I think this will come up in the, I think the individualized screening is fascinating. And then talking about other risk factors, which are more palpable, like BRCA mutations and other mutations.
But if I can just say, until we get to the point that we have individualized screening, follow the recommendations that are out there.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I don't think that the FDA is changing screening recommendations. It's really more around how the testing is reported, right? Okay. Jennifer, talk a little bit about your research and what you're doing around testing, exercise, diet, et cetera.
Sure. So we've known for a long time that there are links between woman's weight, the amount of exercise she does, potentially diet, although that's a lot murkier, and we'll talk about that later, and her risk of developing breast cancer, gynecologic cancers. But we don't know why, and we don't really know whether those are things that you can change that risk by helping people change their behavior, by starting an exercise program, by losing weight. We also know that some of these things continue to be a factor after somebody's diagnosed with breast cancer, gynecologic cancers, and influencing whether that cancer comes back, whether women ultimately end up with cancer that's not curable. And so our group is really interested in trying to figure out not only the why, how could something like exercise or losing weight impact something as complicated as cancer is? We're talking in other breakfasts about all the really exciting new drugs and the technology. Sometimes it's counterintuitive that something as low tech as exercise could have an effect, but we're learning more and more that it's not only the drugs that you treat cancer with, but it's also your own body that influences how you respond to these therapies. So kind of understanding the why. And then the other piece that we're really, really interested in as an oncologist, as a physician, as a woman, can we do something about this? What if we take women who've been diagnosed with breast cancer or who are at risk of breast cancer or endometrial cancer or ovarian cancer, and we help them make these changes? Can we actually impact their risk of developing the disease, their risk of dying from the disease? And that's really what our group has been involved with now for the last decade. The biggest study that we're running right now is actually in the survivorship, the after cancer setting, where we're looking at whether weight loss can prevent recurrence in women with early breast cancer. But we have a lot of other studies that are going on even earlier, looking at, can we look at what happens when somebody starts to exercise, loses weight? How does that affect their body systemically, all the hormones that we have coursing around, and looking actually in tissues to see in breast tissue that could become cancerous over time, what happens when someone starts to exercise? How does that impact the tissue there that could explain why women who exercise have a lower risk of developing breast cancer, or why women who are leaner seem to be at lower risk of developing breast and gynecologic malignancies?
Yeah. So I think that's great, Jen. I think that certainly the role of exercise seems to be pervasive in certainly overall health and reduction of cancer recurrence. I think the other issue that comes up, and the question I'm often asked, is what diet should I be following? I was in New York just a couple of days, and everyone's talking about the keto diet. So there are obviously different diets to follow, right? So there's the Mediterranean diet, the keto diet, vegetarian, vegan. So what do you actually, when a patient asks you that question, obviously you're going to be for breast cancer, but what do you tell her? Because you must tell her something. And then is that applicable to other women's cancers?
I just want to say that Jennifer follows the non-fat mocha latte diet.
It's got milk. It's got caffeine. So I wish I could tell you, all right, the secret is, but after studying this for 10 years, diet's not so simple. And I think we all recognize that you can read a newspaper, listen to the news, and one day you'll hear this is the magical food that will prevent cancer. And then the next week, literally, a study comes out and says, actually, this has been tied to cancer in rats. And so I think this makes it really hard. And sometimes it makes people just throw up their hands and say, everything causes cancer. There is no use even trying. And that's probably not the right thing. But I think the bottom line is there's not a right diet. I wish that there was. There are certain patterns that have been linked to lower risk of developing cancer, but there's not a specific food that you either need to eat every day or that you should avoid completely. And part of the reason this is so challenging is the way we study diet is hard. A lot of times we ask women and men to record, well, what do you eat? And then we follow them over time and we say, oh, people who ate X seem to get more cancer. But we don't know whether it's because of that food. Like, for example, you could study ketchup. And you could say, oh, look, ketchup is linked to a higher risk of developing cancer. But is it because you're putting ketchup on French fries? Or is it because of the ketchup? Or is it because you're eating the ketchup and the French fries instead of the broccoli? There's no way of telling that from this kind of research. And the other thing that we often see in these headlines is that this is all based on studies in mice. Or last year there was a huge study showing that sugar caused cancer in yeast. I did not know yeast could develop cancer, but I think this kind of gets to the fact that there's not a lot of direct evidence in people about a specific food, and it makes it really hard to know what you should be doing, because there are diets are a little bit like religion. There are people who feel really strongly about the way that they eat and the way that it makes them feel. When you look at all this research together, there is a group that tries to put all of these many, many different kinds of studies together and look at not just one study, but look at the whole landscape of this. And it's a group called the World Cancer Research Fund. And every few years, they bring a bunch of experts together and they look at all this and say, okay, what's real and what isn't real? And for diet and breast and gynecologic cancers, really the only things that rise to the top, there's a link between alcohol intake, and I know Eric won't like this, but there's a link between alcohol intake. Well, I didn't mean it like that, but we always have this discussion. You deserved it because of the mocha. There is a link between alcohol intake and the risk of developing breast cancer. How meaningful that is for low levels of alcohol, I think, is subject to a lot of debate, but it gets a lot of press. There's no other food that has really risen to a even reasonable level of evidence that it causes breast or gynecologic cancers. Red meat probably increases the risk of colon cancer, but that's not necessarily what we're talking about today. And the only thing that's been shown to be protective, and the evidence is pretty weak, fruits and vegetables may be linked to a lower risk of hormonally negative breast cancers. Not consistent, not strong, but that's really all that there is when you look across the boundary. So kind of disappointing. I can't really comment on keto versus paleo versus whatever else.
Yeah.
But you're
testing these things.
Right.
Yeah, you're testing these, which is important. But so I think that's important message, is that we don't really know. All right. I've been told we've got 10 minutes. So we're going to fire through these questions. All right, so Dipanjan, question for you. For whom is this new diagnostic test? And how are you going to really kind of start your studies? Will it be in high-risk women?
Yeah, so I think when you say for whom, ultimately we believe it should be for every woman. I mean, the vision is that when you go for your annual physical and your blood is taken to test for cholesterol or every other parameter that is done, there should be, we envision a situation where you could be, with the same blood draw, we could test and get a probability of you having the potential for ovarian or other cancer. So that's the long-term vision, but for the short-term, we believe we can really, we are actually considering starting a trial with Judy for the high-risk patients who have familial cancer, you know, families with BRCA genes or otherwise who we don't know why, but they have, the families have the cancer, to be able to monitor them with a test which gives them some assurance that they don't have the disease and they can be, they don't need the surgery just yet. That's the most immediate application for the test.
That's great. And I think the fact that you're thinking about a clinical trial soon is terrific, because I've had questions about your test because everyone's reading about it. Eric, has the genetic test for BRCA changed/improved since it was first developed in late 1990s? And so I think this also brings up other questions about other genes beyond BRCA1. that confer risk.
So BRCA1 and BRCA2, as most of you probably know, are the two genes that are most consistently and most commonly associated with a high risk of both breast and ovarian cancer. And these are, of course, genes that you inherit in an abnormal state from your mother or your father and can be passed on to your children. They were discovered in the mid-1990s, and the initial testing was reasonably accurate, but it has gotten better over time. And we have been able to test in a way that is that much more accurate than it ever was. At the same time, testing has become much less expensive. It used to be thousands of dollars. It's now hundreds of dollars, and actually a small number of hundreds. And in addition to BRCA1 and 2, there's testing that is typically done. This is called panel testing for a whole range of other genetic changes, some of which we know what to do with and some of which we're not so sure of. But at this point in time, I would say the vast majority of women with breast and ovarian cancer are tested, and it will soon be virtually all women with breast and ovarian cancer are tested for this panel of genes, both because it may affect some treatment choices, it may affect the way they talk about their cancer risk with their families, and because it's becoming part of standard care. The time that used to, or the concern that used to exist of insurance discrimination is really no longer a major issue.
Right. And if someone's been tested for BRCA in the past, and it just concluded maybe just BRCA 1 or 2 or just an abbreviated panel, would you recommend testing again?
So the official recommendation is yes. I think in particular if someone was tested for BRCA 1 and 2 many, many years ago, because the testing for BRCA 1 and 2 is so much better today, yeah, that they should be retested. In terms of the other genes, you know, for the most part, with the exception of one or two, there's not as much to be learned, but the standard recommendation would be to be retested if one didn't have panel testing.
Sounds good. A question for Eric and for Jennifer about aspirin. I know that aspirin has been looked at so Eric, I know, is running a trial for breast cancer, but aspirin use has also been looked at for ovary, as a preventative use, but also taking it during diagnosis. Comments?
I'll just take one quick piece of this, and then
you
don't want to answer.
No.
Okay. Jennifer's just afraid I'll make more comments about the mocha latte. So the epidemiologic evidence suggests that aspirin could potentially help prevent a recurrence of breast cancer, but these are data from the Nurses' Health Study and from other large cohorts, but is not the kind of data that should lead to a treatment recommendation at this point in time. And so, with that in mind, our colleague Wendy Chen actually was awarded a very large grant from the Department of Defense several years ago, and we are conducting a 3,000-person study in the United States. A very similar trial is being conducted in the UK, randomizing women to a placebo or to aspirin after a diagnosis of breast cancer to see if this intervention could possibly help prevent recurrence. I think we all think it's a long shot, but it's such an easy treatment that if it were a winner, it would be a big winner. Mm-hmm. And so we should have an answer in the next few years. Interestingly, we for people who have side effects, we have dose reductions of both the placebo and the aspirin. So if you're getting the placebo and you get side effects, you reduce to a baby placebo. And if you get the aspirin and you have side effects, you go on a baby aspirin.
You know, it's interesting because in ovary cancer that the dose of the aspirin seems to, again, at least in these retrospective studies, makes a difference, where perhaps low-dose aspirin has more protective effect and higher dose, 325, less so. Comments about the dosing of aspirin?
We struggled with this.
Yeah.
And we really were unsure what dose to use. We ultimately decided to use one full European aspirin, which is very slightly smaller than an American aspirin, because it's what Bayer would give us. We decided that if we looked at low-dose aspirin and the study were negative, people would criticize it and say you should have looked at a slightly higher dose. They could criticize us for looking at the higher dose, too.
Yeah. Jen, so I have a question here. What role does diet play in the treatment of ovarian cancer?
I think there is a lot less information about diet during chemotherapy treatment. Mm-hmm. There are some guidelines that recommend that people make sure they get enough protein intake during chemotherapy. I think there's a lot more evidence now emerging about muscle loss during chemotherapy, not just for ovarian cancer, but more broadly. And this is true, especially the older you get. And so there's a lot of interest in trying to help people maintain physical activity and maintain protein intake during chemotherapy to help prevent some of that. But I don't know of any other specific recommendations about dietary elements during ovarian cancer treatment specifically.
Yeah, we have another question about kind of there's a focus on BMI, but there's also a focus on muscle versus fat percentage. I'm not sure what that exactly means, but I mean, I think in terms of you're talking about muscle loss during chemotherapy, and so patients should be really, and women should be really taking in more protein. That's actually a good recommendation. I'm not so sure we necessarily focus on that as much.
The dietitians, if you send your patients for a nutrition consult, that's one of the things that they talk about. Do you want me to talk about the BMI thing briefly?
Sure, go ahead. Yeah.
They don't want you to talk very long, though.
Oh, we're getting a red flag.
Okay.
All right. So Jen, I want to take a couple, each of you just give a kind of a 30-second conclusion. So, Jen, why don't you start? Kind of just closing thoughts.
Sure. So, I think a lot of people say, well, what can I do to help reduce my risk of developing cancer? And I think that we know more than we ever have before about that. We don't have perfect evidence. I think one of the things, as Eric talked about, trying to find personalized prevention strategies, screening strategies, this is another area where we really need to know for an individual woman, what do we tell her to optimize the likelihood that she'll never develop breast or ovarian or any other cancer. But there are guidelines now that suggest higher levels of physical activity, eating a diet that we all know is good for us, lots of fruits and vegetables, things that you buy whole versus from a package, keeping your weight in a good range, not only seems to be good for general health, but does seem to be linked to a lower risk of many of the cancers that we're talking about today.
Great. Eric?
Well, I think I've already given you the conclusion about screening, but we're going to get a lot smarter about screening. And again, I say we very broadly. I'm not going to be doing that research. We're going to get a lot smarter about screening over the course of the next decade. And prevention, I always say, is a hard nut to crack. I think it would be more straightforward if we come up with ways of preventing cancers that involve dietary changes or exercise. Most people don't want to take a drug with side effects to prevent something that may be relatively rare. So that's where the personalized approaches become very, very important.
Yeah, that's great. And Dipanjan?
It's a really exciting time to do science with the technology and particularly in this area in Boston. So I can just say that if 10 years ago somebody had told me we would be where we are, I wouldn't have believed it. We are very lucky to be where we are in a lot of ways that we know what we are looking for. And I really believe that with resources and with the samples which are actually pouring in worldwide, we should be able to get to early detection for a lot of these cancers in the foreseeable future.
Terrific. Thank you so much. I want to thank the panel for being here. And thank you, Jen, Eric, and Dipanjan.